Scleroderma is diagnosed based on a combination of factors. It's definitely not just a positive blood test. It involves the clinical features that support the diagnosis. Many patients come in as a referral to our center because they have a positive blood test known as the ANA. And a positive ANA is also known as a positive anti-nuclear antibody. And that is a marker that can be detected in the blood that occurs and is found in many patients with autoimmune disease. Now, there are several subtypes of this marker that are more specific for scleroderma. Some of those that are more commonly tested include the anti-topoisomerase 1 antibody, which is also known as the scleroderma 70 antibody, anti-centromere antibody, and anti-RNA Pol-3 antibody. And it's often a question of referral because many patients come with a positive test and may not have signs of clinical disease. And if they don't and they have a positive test alone, we may monitor them over time, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they have the disease. Now, if a patient comes with clinical symptoms and has one of these antibodies that are positive, it can be incredibly helpful in determining what type of scleroderma they'll potentially develop, meaning that patients with certain antibodies are more likely to develop specific organ complications. When a patient comes into my office for a clinic visit, at the time of the exam, I'll look for several things. So starting with the head, patients may have skin thickening or some swelling around the eyes, which can occur, and tightening of the oral aperture or opening of the mouth. Patients may also have loss of skin pigmentation at the hairline, and they may notice some changes in their facial appearance. Again, this is not present in everybody. Other findings on the face may include little red spots called telangiectasias and are not painful or not raised, but when compressed with your finger, they blanch or go away and then they return as the capillaries or post-capillary venules on the face refill. On the chest, we also may see those red dots or telangiectasias. Patients may have abnormal heart sounds, suggestive of something such as pulmonary hypertension, which can present with a heave or a loud P2 on the cardiac exam. They may have dry crackles in the lungs, suggestive of pulmonary fibrosis. And they may have an elevated jugular venous pressure, which can also be associated with pulmonary hypertension. In addition to that, patients can have contractures. This is almost essentially only seen in the diffuse cutaneous patient population where they actually have trouble moving their joints. So patients may have trouble raising their arms out to the side, raising them above their head. And they may have something called tendon friction rubs, which almost feel like a creaking, like a tin man would make. It's felt on exam as a rub. Patients may also have a distended abdomen or decreased bowel sounds, depending on if they have significant gastrointestinal involvement. They can have weak muscles, which is detected on the musculoskeletal exam. They can have swelling in their legs if they have a complication such as heart failure or pulmonary hypertension. And on their fingers, the findings can also vary. They can have puffy fingers. They can have skin thickening anywhere from head to toe. They can have dilation, dropout, or abnormal nail fold capillaries, which are detected by dermatoscope. They can also have discoloration of the skin, swollen joints, and a variety of other findings that we can see.